Well, I think it's sort of ironic because in a certain sense, this is one of the most neutral pieces in the whole museum. And yet for me, it's really loaded with this meaning and in a very kind of pertinent meaning to my own work. And the reason that there's an irony in that is that it's sort of the whole Irwin's gestural idea was to remove the gesture from his work and sort of confront you with this perceptual state. And in this case, this state is supposed to, you know, be sort of the primacy of perception is how he described it. So it's this state that happens before you kind of impress your own meanings on something. There's this very theoretical approach to his work. But if we look at it, there's also this very perceptual, tangible quality. Olafur Eliasson is quoted as saying about Irwin that he has the ability to make the theoretical tangible. And I think that that's a really kind of an interesting way to think about it. Irwin had these sort of models and these ideas and these philosophies that he was exploring, but ultimately he was interested in kind of interjecting these into a tangibility and expressing that with an object, or at least in this case, when he was doing abstract expressionist paintings. And this was in the mid-50s. He was living in Los Angeles and had grown up there, and he got involved at this gallery called Ferris Gallery, and it was a sort of a young, energetic, abstract expressionist kind of scene that was happening there in Los Angeles. He was doing these really large, very gestural paintings, you know, spreading colors in different ways and kind of working in a very emotive gestural style. He developed this model about the double nature of painting, in the sense that he believes that there's this, you know, on one side there's this imagery that's happening, which is referential, which is symbolic, which is the thing that has that carries the meaning and refers to something that is outside of the painting, is representational of, you know, like a man walking down the street, for instance. Whereas he also believed there was the second nature of painting, which was the physical nature of painting, which represented an immediacy and allowed you to consider the painting as a presence in its own right and not as a reference to something else outside in the outside world. And it sort of is existing as its own kind of presence. So this sort of idea emerges out of his period as an abstract expressionist painter, and he wants to push that idea farther. So he sort of is thinking about how he can reduce his gestures and what would be the simplest sort of mark that he could make that would maybe amplify this physicality and yet also reduce this quality of imagery in the painting. His reason for making this departure from the world is to sort of try to shed some of this, what he thinks of as kind of a conditioning of applying meaning to things. So he's trying to sort of step away from this way of looking at the world and really trying to engage this more immediate perception. And he does this by this very studied, careful method of painting, whereas he will, you know, sit and consider a single line across a color field for days, and will maybe make a hairline adjustment. You know, for me, it becomes an interesting question there in terms of the consideration of the audience in general in making work. I think in art, that's a question that is sort of important to address. And you know, his retreat from the world gave him this kind of unique perspective and allowed him to develop these ideas. But then when he brought them back in, there was this disconnect that happened. And it was because of this disconnect that, in a certain sense, that drove him back to the studio to make work that would better represent the ideas that he was really trying to explore and communicate. And in a lot of ways, I think that art is really about this communication. You know, if the idea isn't communicated, or you're not concerned about communicating like any sort of idea or concept, or if you're not interested in communicating at all, then it's a question of why are you putting your work out in the world? Why not just do it and stay in your studio and live that sort of hermetic lifestyle forever? Clearly, there's a concern to have this be a communication. And in many ways, what's wonderful about art is it's this communication that is possible that sort of goes about happening beyond language. I can stand here and talk about this piece for a long time, or we could just stare at it and appreciate it, and that would be a totally different kind of experience. During 1966, 1967, he was making a whole bunch of different discs, most of them similar to this form, although there's some that are bisected as well. The time that he had spent before neutralizing the wall space and getting out all these inconsistencies, he now becomes interested in activating the wall space and the lighting. Whereas before those were just things that he was trying to neutralize, he's now bringing them in to the work. And there's a slight issue here in that this piece isn't necessarily mounted exactly to Irwin's specifications. You know, in the ideal scenario, we would have two lamps back here, 6 feet back, and there's these two on the top are sort of in their right place. He even went on to go so far as to describe the exact type of bulb that you would want to use, and then also a pale blue filter that would filter out some of the yellow tones. And if you notice the edge here, it has this blue tone to it. So he wanted to kind of remove that yellow so that the shadow would blend from the disc into the wall. And that was really the idea. These four sort of lights would hit it. We're sort of getting the effect here with these two circles, but if you can imagine four circles behind it, sort of a rosette, and these edges would really sort of effervesce and disappear into the shadows behind it. That was the intention in his original mounting. And it was a circle, first of all, because he wanted to, again, neutralize his gesture. A circle being more neutral than a square. There's no corners, so there's no focal point in that will draw your eye to it. He's removing that that distraction. It's also probably hard to tell, depending on where you're sitting, but it is shaped in a convex way. It comes out of the wall. Although if you're looking straight at it, you can't tell if it's convex or concave or flat. It sort of has this mystery in terms of its shape. And he really saw this dissolving of the frontier between the object and the environment as part of a progression that had been going on for, according to him, for 500 years. So if you trace his lineage, it starts with the paintings of Christ and the religious iconography of early visual art, and moves to it becomes okay to paint a king, and then it becomes okay to paint a merchant, a wealthy merchant, and then it becomes okay to paint a handmaiden who's wearing a red shawl. And the eventuality of that is it becomes, it reaches a stage where it's okay to just paint the color red and appreciate that. And it's this flattening of this value structure that makes that possible, what he calls a merging of the figure and the ground. In this case, the figure would be this disc and the ground is the background, and they're merging together. The disc here is made to be experienced in person in this very immediate and physical way. And I think I was kind of seeking a similar sort of physical immediacy in working with these instruments. It's a momentary and an elusive quality that that becomes available only when you're in front of the object. And I think that for me is a very, there's something very valuable in that.